So, Jose, take it away.
Okay, thank you very much, and thanks for the invitation. I'm very happy to be able to talk to you. And yeah, so as you said, please ask questions at any point, and don't hesitate. So yeah, I'm going to talk about this geometrical trinity of gravity, and probably some of its main features and the problems that we usually encounter when we try to go beyond this trinity. And sorry. Okay, it works, right? Okay. So this is the outline that I will try to follow. I will start by introducing this geometrical framework of gravity, trying to argue why it's natural to describe gravity in geometrical terms. And then, embracing this geometrical framework of gravity, I will introduce the geometrical trinity, that is, how we can describe gravity or associate gravity to different geometrical objects in a general metric affine framework. And then, as I said, I will talk about the dangers below this trinity because, well, I guess you're all familiar with the fact that GR is a very delicate theory. And as soon as you try to mess up with its structure, you get into to problems because you have ghosts, instabilities, and all kinds of issues. And so I prepare one slide to talk about matter fields and how you can consistently couple these three formulations of gravity to matter, but I will be very brief about that. So if you ask yourself what is general relativity, and first thing I usually do is I Google it, and then this is what you find. And then you are very quickly convinced that the GR is a theory that describes the curvature of space-time. I will try to argue here that this is conventional and there is nothing really deep about this. And in fact, we can describe the very same theory in terms of torsion and non-metricity. So to go there, let's start from what we know about gravity, and that is that gravity is a long-range force, as far as we know. If it has a mass, it has a very small mass. It's attractive and it's universal, so it affects all particles in the universe. And it has also a very special property, and is that its coupling constant, its charge, is precisely the inertial mass. And that means that we have the equivalence principle. So all particles fall the same way in a gravitational field. So with this piece of information, we can try to borrow ideas from electromagnetism and say, okay, can we do the same as we do with quantum electrodynamics that we build in terms of a massless spin one particle that is the photon and that carries some interaction? We can try to do that, but then the first question is how do we characterize a graviton, or what is a graviton? And funnily enough, if you search for a graviton, well, I don't know if you know about this, but I discovered that it's actually a superhero, and its superpower is that he can control gravity. So this is not the guy I'm going to talk about, but it's you can go in and search for it. It's I didn't know about that. So if we want to answer this question, then why is it natural that gravity is described by a massless spin two particle? I guess you all know why this is so, and it's because it's long range, so it must be massless, and it's attractive, so it must have spin either zero or two, because one will give you a repulsive force. But we know that light is affected by gravity, and that means that spin zero wouldn't do a good job because it doesn't couple to traceless energy momentum tensor. So the only possibility is spin two. And then we add this additional information that we want a local theory, Lorentz invariant, and four dimensions. And the interesting, remarkable thing is that with these ingredients, if you try to construct a consistent theory for this particle, you find that it has to interact with itself, unlike the photon. So if you want, it's more similar to a Jacques-Mills theory, non-abelian theory. And the interactions must be consistent with the gauge symmetry that you need to keep the masslessness of the particle. And when you do this consistently, you see that eventually you get general relativity, up to some small caveats, but those are that this works at sufficiently long distances. So it's the low energy effective field theory for this particle. you need to complete the gate symmetry at each order, so you get a sort of non-linear realization of the initial gate symmetry. And you might complain that log-log terms cannot be recovered by this procedure. And this is true, but this will be a problem in higher dimensions. In four dimensions, the first non-trivial log-log invariant besides the Ricci scalar and the cosmological constant is the Gauss bonnet, that is a topological invariant. So for us, that wouldn't be a problem. And when we want to couple this particle to matter fields, we find that it must couple with the same coupling constant with same strength to all particles, to all matter fields. And this is another way of rephrasing that you must fulfill the equivalence principle. And it's precisely this requirement of having the equivalence principle what allows for a geometrical description of gravity. Because since all particles or all fields fall or move in the same way in on a gravitational field, that means that we can give a geometrical description that will depend on the gravitational field that we have around. But is this equivalence principle what allows to have a geometrical description? And this is what distinguishes general relativity from other gauge theories of lower spin. So then with all these ingredients, we find that general relativity can be described in terms of the Ricci scalar of a metric that generates a connection, the Levi-Civita connection, and the curvature of this connection gives you, if you want, the gravitational field, okay? But this is starting from the massless spin two particle, and the geometrical interpretation emerges from there, from the, if you want, the non-linearities or the interactions. But now, if we embrace this geometrical approach of gravity, we could say, okay, what about we try to extend or formulate a theory in a geometrical setup. Then, as you know, a space-time manifold admits a metric structure. This is the metric that we have that we usually associate to the graviton, but it also admits a completely independent affine structure. And this is described by the connection. In the usual formulation of general relativity, what we do is we linked the metric and the affine structure, because the affine connection is the Levi-Civita connection of the metric. But in general, a connection can be split in this way. So I remind you, it's an independent object in four dimensions. It has 64 different components. This is a lot of freedom that you have in the connection and that we usually don't use because we fix it to be the Levi-Civita. And this is this piece here. So whenever you have a metric, you can split the Levi-Civita apart in terms of this so-called non-metricity that precisely measures the incompatibility of the metric with the connection. So this gives you what is called usually the disformation tensor. And then the antisymmetric part of the connection gives you the torsion, and this contributes the connection with this so-called contortion. And these are the definitions. They have nice geometric interpretations. You know, curvature measures the angle between a vector that is parallel transported along a closed curve. Torsion measures the property of a space-time that parallelograms do not close. So if I take this vector and parallel transport it along this one, and then I do the same with this one along this one, then if they don't close, it's because you have torsion. And non-metricity has to do with the variation of the length of vectors as you move around the space-time, okay? Also, the angles between vectors can vary. Now, you could already complain, because why do we need all these objects and weird things if we are very happy with general relativity? Well, it's not completely crazy to use this geometrical framework, because actually this occurs in many condensed matter systems and in many systems in general. So if you look at the propagation of light inside some material, you find that it can be described in terms of a Riemannian geometry, of a Riemannian metric. The same with sound waves in a fluid. And there is very interesting, because you can even form horizons like here. This is an experiment you can do at home. And in general, whenever you have nonlinear theories and you have perturbations propagating on some non-trivial background, you will see that these perturbations move in an effective Riemannian geometry. And similarly, the affine structure appears in context master system when you have defects like line defects or dislocations or these point-like defects. For instance, in this type of material where you have a line defect, the propagation of phonons phonons on this material will see an effective torsion because you see if you transport yourself 1, 2, 3, 4 that direction, 1, 2, 3 in that direction, then 4 in that direction, and then 3 in that direction, then they do not close. And this is precisely what I told you is the property of having torsion. And nonmetricity can be associated to a density of point-like defects where you have either bigger or smaller atoms in this system. So it's natural to describe systems. Natural, I guess it's a subjective term, but it makes sense to try to study these general affine geometries. And in particular in gravity, because as we saw, it admits a natural geometric interpretation. So then you can start playing with a general connection and you can go to this affinitia land. And there you can have very different ratios that have been studied a lot in the literature. In the most general framework where this is the so-called metric affine gravity, that's the gauge theory of the affine group. In general, you can have non-metricity, torsion, and curvature, but you can start introducing constraints. And if you don't allow for torsion or non-metricity, then you can formulate GR in the usual way. You can have geometries where the curvature is zero. These are called flat Volter parallel geometries. You can have torsion and curvature, and then you have these Einstein-Cartan theories. You can have non-metricity, and this is a paradigmatic example, the Weyl geometries. So you can have a very rich family or fauna of theories, of frameworks. What I'm going to focus on here is these homes of Einstein, where you have the usual formulation of general relativity with in terms of curvature, but there is also a formulation of the very same theory in a flat geometry without non-metricity and only in terms of torsion. And the same with non-metricity. You can formulate GR also in a space-time without torsion nor curvature and only in terms of non-metricity. And this is what I'm going to try to explain next. So first, let's start with trying to ascribe gravity to torsion. So we want to get rid of curvature and non-metricity. So we impose these conditions. Then at lowest order, what we usually do is we write down the more general quadratic term that we can form with our fundamental object. In this case, there are three independent contractions you can build, these three, and you have these three independent parameters. So in terms of this quadratic form, you write your action with this quadratic form, and then you impose these conditions with some Lagrange multipliers, okay? You can work with the Lagrange multipliers or you can solve for the constraints. If you do that, the first constraint tells you that the Riemann must be zero. And this can be immediately integrated because we know that the Riemann is the field strength of the GL, the general linear affine connection. So this means that the connection must be pure gauge in the general linear group. So that another way, gamma, the connection must be written, must take the form of lambda minus one alpha nu, d mu, lambda nu beta. I don't know how clear this is. If it's not clear, please ask. But this is the same as saying that if you have an electromagnetic field with f mu nu equals zero, the vector potential must be partial mu theta, pure gauge, okay? And this lambda is what is usually called pure gauge connection or inertial connection. The other constraint imposes this equation, and this gives you a relation between this inertial connection lambda and the metric. And this can be integrated also quite easily and it tells you that the metric is related to this lambda through this relation, where in principle this eta alpha beta are some constants. It's a constant tensor. It's not determined by this. But if you want to recover local Lorentz invariance, this must be the Minkowski metric. Okay. Of course, here you are recognizing the fact that this lambda is nothing but a Firbine, okay, in the usual formulation. Then this is in general, but there is a special choice of these parameters, A, B, and C. And as usual, this is determined by symmetries. If you choose the parameters in this way, there is an additional local Lorentz symmetry realized with the inertial connection that is realized up to a total derivative. Since you have an additional symmetry, this means that you have fewer degrees of freedom, right? Because you have redundant modes. And in this case, you can see that if you write your action in terms of the inertial connection only, then you recover general relativity. This can be seen by either expanding the action at a linear order, if you want, at quadratic order in the action, but it holds at full nonlinear level. And I will show later how this comes about. But the important thing is that with these parameters, you have an additional symmetry, and this allows you to reduce the theory to general relativity, which is actually a necessary requirement because lambda is a 4x4 matrix, has 16 components, and in the end you want two. You have different morphisms, but that only removes 8. So you need to remove 6 additional modes, and those are those of the local Lorentz symmetry. And that's what allows you to go from 16 to 2. In the case of these so-called symmetric teleparallelisms, we try to describe gravity in terms of the nonmetricity. So this is our only object. And then, so we do the same and we impose that the Riemann is zero, the torsion is zero now, and we write down the most general quadratic form in terms of the nonmetricity. In this case, we have 5 independent parameters because we have 5 independent terms that we can write. And then we do the same. We write our Lagrangian, our action with the quadratic form, impose the constraints with Lagrange multipliers. This one is the same as before. So the connection is pure gauge. It must be described in terms of this 4x4 matrix. But now the torsionless constraint tells you that this connection must be symmetric. Now, if you anti-symmetrize this in mu beta, you find that, well, lambda minus 1 is non-degenerate because there is a minus 1, there is an inverse. So it tells you that this anti-symmetrization must be 0. And the solution for that is that lambda must take the form of some Jacobian, if you want. It's the partial derivative of some functions. You see that trivially, this form for the connection fulfills that it has vanishing torsion. But now the important or the interesting thing is that if you plug this form for the connection here, you find that the connection takes the form precisely of a coordinate transformation. So that means that I can perform, since I have different morphisms, I can perform a coordinate transformation to completely remove the connection. And then I can trivialize it by choosing these coordinates. If I choose these coordinates, then this is a constant and then derivative is zero. So I have a trivial connection, okay? In this case, this gauge is usually called coincident gauge, but it's interesting to notice that what we have obtained here is that the connection described in terms of this exercise is nothing but a way of restoring some different morphism invariance with some Stuckeberg fields. And this coincident gauge is nothing but the usual unitary gauge whenever you introduce these Stuckeberg fields. Now we can again ask ourselves if there is some special case. And of course, the answer is yes. And it's when you take the quadratic form, these coefficients, in this way, okay, with these values. When you do this, you can see that the connection can be written actually in terms of this disformation that I told you before, like this. Okay, so it can be written in this form. But then we can go to the coincident gauges. In the coincident gauges, gamma is zero. And if you remember, the connection gamma was the in geometry without torsion was the Levi-Civita plus this L. If gamma is zero, it means that this L is minus the Levi-Civita. So I can plug this here, and what you obtain is nothing but the Einstein axiom of general relativity. This is the Lagrangian or the axiom that you obtain from the Einstein-Hilbert axiom from the Ricci scalar when you remove the total derivative. So you know that the Ricci scalar has a part that is partial gamma and then gamma squared. The partial gamma, they all combine in the total derivative. So it's irrelevant for the equations of motion. And the gamma squared part that you get is precisely this. So in the coincident gauge, this theory reduces to the Einstein formulation of general relativity. So in this case, it should be obvious that this theory, in terms of non-metricity, is equivalent, not equivalent, is the same as general relativity. There is an advantage of this formulation, and is that you know that usually for the Einstein-Hilbert axiom to have a well-posed variational principle, you need to include the Gibbon-Hawking-Jock terms to remove the variations of the derivatives from the boundary. And this is because precisely these total derivatives that contribute second derivatives of the metric. In this case, we only have first derivatives. So you don't need to have any, if you want, boundary term to have a well-posed variational principle. The price to pay is that now diffeomorphisms are only realized up to a total derivative. So this Lagrangian, in principle, is it depends on the coordinates. Another interesting property of this form of writing general relativity is that it should be obvious that the G Newton, the Newton's constant, doesn't receive quantum corrections from graviton loops. Because as I said, this axiom realizes diffeomorphisms up to a total derivative. And the quantum corrections, being variations of the axiom, will give you terms that are exactly diffeomorphism invariants. So they cannot contribute to the reverse normalization of the Planck mass that should be there. Okay, so this is what we have seen so far. And it's these three formulations of general relativity in terms of curvature. This is the one we are taught usually and that we all know. This is the formulation in terms of torsion, where the fundamental field is this inertial connection. And this is a formulation where only non-metricity enters through these fields, psi, that can be trivialized with a coordinate transformation. And well, I guess now it's more or less apparent why we call this the geometrical trinity. I don't know how good of a Christians you are. I am not a very good Christian, so I prefer this interpretation of the trinity. But so what is the what lies at the heart of this, if you want, trinity of formulations of general relativity? Well, in the end is that we are trying to describe a massless pin-to field. And as I argued before, this imposes the equivalence principle. And this is what allows a geometrical description of gravity. Now, whether you want to call that curvature, torsion, or non-metricity, or something else, is up to you, okay? But, so that's why I was saying at the beginning that saying that gravity is the curvature of space-time, I know it's very useful because we have good geometrical tools to work with this, but it can also be described in terms of torsion or non-metricity. And we also have tools to work with these geometries. Okay. Now, if you look at these two, they are both formulated in geometries where the Riemann is zero. So they are flat geometries. They are teleparallel geometries, if you want. The question now would be if we can have a formulation of general relativity. Sorry, I didn't explain this. And so this is the equivalence that we have between the teleparallel equivalence and general relativity, that in a space-time that is metric, meaning that the non-metricity is zero, the Ricci of the total connection is related to the Ricci of the Levi-Civita by this relation, okay? Where this T is the special quadratic form that we used for to describe general relativity. And if the connection is flat, the Riemann is zero, so this is zero, And then the difference between the Ricci and T is just a total derivative that I can draw. So the difference between this action and this action is a total derivative. And in this sense, it should be, I don't know if obvious, but clear that they describe the same theory. And similarly, if you have a space-time where torsion vanishes, you have this relation between the curvatures of the total connection and the Levi-Civita connection. And again, since the Riemann is zero, this is zero, and then the difference between the Ricci scalar of the Levi-Civita connection of the metric and this quadratic form of the non-metricity is a total derivative. So these two theories differ by a total derivative, okay? And now what I wanted to explain next is, okay, these are formulated in flat connections, with a flat connection. Can we have something more general with a flat connection? Well, let's try. So this is the question. Is there a general teleparallel equivalent without imposing the vanishing of non-metricity or the torsion? Okay, so if we integrate the only constraint we have now, we have that the connection takes this form. And this has a global GL4 symmetry, right? Because if it's global, the transformation of this object will commute with the total, with the partial derivative, and then it will cancel the inverse from here. So there's a global symmetry. Now, can we make this this symmetry local symmetry? Okay, so we do the same. We write down the most general quadratic form, but now with the torsion and non-metricity. Now it's a mess, and you could try to find a choice of parameters that gives you something interesting, but we can use the same trick. So now the Ricci scalar is related with the Ricci scalar of the Levi-Civita connection by this, okay? Again, we find this total derivative, and now this quadratic form is this one. So now I only need to choose these parameters with these values, and then I will have an equivalent of general relativity because R is zero. So the difference between R and this quadratic form will be a total derivative. And this means that this theory will differ from general relativity by a total derivative. So they give you the same dynamics. So both will give you the same Einstein equations if you want. And now the two teleparallel formulations that we saw before, the teleparallel equivalent or the symmetric teleparallel equivalent, can be interpreted as just two gauge fixed versions of this more general teleparallel equivalent of GR. Okay. Now, what I'm saying is that all these different formulations differ by total derivatives. And this could be seen as a purely academic thing, but it has so it can help you with some computations. For instance, let's consider a Schwarzschild black hole in Schwarzschild coordinates. So it's described by this metric. And then in GR, we know that if you want to compute the entropy of the black hole, the whole entropy comes from the boundary Gibbon-Hawking-Yorke term, right? Because this is a solution of the vacuum Einstein equations. That means that the Ricci is zero. So this gives you a vanishing contribution to the Euclidean action. And everything comes from the total, from the boundary term. If you compute that, you find that it's actually divergent and you have to regularize it. So you have to remove the contribution from some more or less ad hoc reference metric. And we usually take Minkowski, which is a natural reference metric. Only when you do all that, you find the standard result for the entropy of the black hole. Now, in our case, we don't have boundary terms because the equations are already first order. Now, the ambiguity or the difficulty now comes from the fact that the action is coordinate dependent. So depending on the coordinate that you choose, you will find a different entropy. And this can be seen, for instance, in these three examples that I give here. If you compute the entropy in the Schwarzschild coordinates, the same, you find that it diverges and then you need to regularize. And in the end, you can find the same value, but you need to introduce some regularization. If you use isotropic coordinates, you find that without any need for regularization, you find a finite value. But the problem is that it gives you a, well, I don't know if it's a problem. The curiosity is that it gives you a factor of 2 different from the standard result. But if you use these Kerr-Seal coordinates where the metric can be written this way, then not only you find a finite result without having to introduce boundary terms nor regularization, but you find the standard result. And this is what one could argue that could be used to define a sort of canonical frame, whatever that means, okay? So it's not only purely academic, but it can give you some insights on some computations. Now, you might be complaining that in this case, you have an ambiguity in the value of the entropy for the black hole, because depending on your coordinates, you find a different value. This ambiguity is also hidden here. Not so much in the regularization scheme that you introduce here, but in the fact that this Gibbon Hawking boundary term is actually not unique. So this is one choice that allows you to reproduce, to find Einstein equations with a well-posed variational principle, but you could add some other terms on the boundary that will still allow you to find the Einstein equations, and it would modify the entropy of the black hole. So the ambiguity in the boundary term here is ambiguity in the coordinates here. So it's just one thing for the other. Now I want to talk about the problems that we usually have whenever we try to abandon the trinity and try to modify gravity starting from these different approaches. So as I said before, you already know from the standard formulation of general relativity that whenever you want to modify GR, you find problems. Already given a mass is a non-trivial task, but even keeping the masslessness, so if you don't want to give up on diffeomorphisms, if you introduce Riemann squared terms, you have ghosts. If you introduce non-minimally coupled fields, unless you do it very carefully, you have ghosts. If you have a coupling, I don't know, to a vector field, Rμ nu, Mu nu, you have ghosts. And usually you have ghosts. And this is because of course, because you run into this Ostrogradsky instability, because the Ricci scalar has second derivatives. So whenever you do something funny with it, you will end up with fourth order equation of motion. In this case, the equations of motion are first order, but similar problems arise, and I will show what is the problem in this case. The first thing I want to discuss is how in these non-linear extensions of the teleparallel theories, Minkowski is pathological. Okay, let's see how this is. If we take this non-linear extension of G, this is something like going from R to F of R, then very much like there, we can linearize in the Ricci, because we use the fact that this G is given by R plus this, the total derivative of this object. So this is just G for a flat connection. This is these are some auxiliary fields. And then we do as usual. You perform this Legendre transformation, and now you have this coupling to the Ricci of this scalar field, you perform a conformal transformation, and you end up with Einstein-Hilbert for the conformal Legendre transformetric, a scalar field that takes into account the nonlinearities. So this is what you would obtain in F of R. But now, from the non-Riemannian contributions, if you want, you get these pieces. This, in the case of Q and T, reduced to this known in the community forms. But the thing here is that you are coupling, so this vector, this scalar field couples to these objects. And now let's study this action around Minkowski. So we take a constant value for the scalar field with some perturbations, then the metric is Minkowski plus perturbations, and the connection is identity plus perturbations. When you plug these fields here, you obtain this quadratic action. This is the standard quadratic action of GR for the gravitational waves. This is the kinetic term for the scalar field coming from here. This is a mass term generated by this potential. And then you have these interactions. Well, this is trivially zero because upon integrations by parts, this goes there, and then symmetric, anti-symmetric, this drops. And this is already a signal that something pathological is going to happen, because the anti-symmetric part of the connection, if you want, is the component of the connection along the Lorentz group, or the Lorentz part of the general linear connection. So this means that this will have an accidental local Lorentz symmetry. But it's even worse than that, because we have this mixing between the graviton and the scalar field, and we can perform this linearized conformal transformation, if you want, to diagonalize this term. And surprisingly, or not so surprisingly, you obtain that upon this diagonalization, you get this standard quadratic term for h mu nu plus this mass term, but without kinetic term. That means that pi also drops from the action. And essentially, you recover the spectrum of general relativity. So only the gravitational waves propagate at linear order around Minkowski in this general theory. And this is a problem, because we know that the full theory has a richer spectrum. It has more degrees of freedom. If they don't show up around this Minkowski background, it means that they are strongly coupled on that background. So as soon as we turn on perturbations or interactions, they will immediately destabilize your Minkowski background. So Minkowski is not a stable background for this series. I would say this is a problem, a very bad thing for this series, and that will make them completely unviable for phenomenology, I would say. And so, as I said before, so what is really the problem with all these theories? Well, the problem is that we have this non-metricity quadratic form. If we go to the coincident gates, we exhaust the diffeomorphisms. And then in these coincident gates, the diffeomorphisms of this are realized only up to a total derivative. And whenever you want to extend it, either you lose the diffeomorphisms or you lose diffeomorphisms. Because if you go nonlinear, the total derivatives that appear when you perform a diffeomorphism will become physical. And if you break them by the tuning, the parameters that make Q, so these parameters, so if you don't use the ones of general relativity, you get this quadratic action. And we know that unless you impose gate symmetries for this h mu nu, you have ghosts in the vector modes or in the scalar modes. So the problem that we had for the standard formulation, that the Ricci contains second derivatives, and then whenever you do something funny, you get higher order of motion, so additional degrees of freedom. In these formulations, the problem is that you use very easily break the diffeomorphisms or the symmetries of the theory. And those will be responsible for additional degrees of freedom. And those degrees of freedom that are associated to the breaking of gate symmetries are usually ghost-like, okay? It's like the tuning in F mu nu, the coefficient Y minus one of electromagnetism, okay? So this is what I said before. So I don't know how I'm doing with time. How much do I have? Like 20 minutes or?
Yeah, probably 12 to 15 minutes, something like that.
Okay. So this is what I said. So let me explain a bit more in detail what I was trying to say. So if we consider F of R, and we use the relation between the Ricci scalar and the non-metricity quadratic form, we have this. And this is different from F of Q, okay? Because there is this total derivative difference. So F of Q is different from F of R. Okay, now let's consider a cosmological background in the coincident gates, okay? So we are using the diffeomorphisms to trivialize the connection. Now, once we have done that, we don't have diffeomorphisms anymore. So we are not free to fix any gates. In particular, now we are not free in principle to fix the laps to 1 or A or whatever you want. However, for this particular theory, F of Q, if you compute the action in mini superspace, you realize that you have this accidental invariance under time reparametrizations. And well, this is sort of good because it allows you to reobtain the continuity equation of the matter sector from some sort of Bianchi identities, even though you don't have Bianchi identities per se, from the Bianchi identities of the gravitational equations, okay? But we will see that this is actually a problem for the consistency of this series, phenomenological consistency. Well, you can see that, well, this is interesting that this particular theory that is not equivalent of GR gives you the same background evolution as GR, because when you plug this here, you obtain the same Freeman equations. But this is just a curiosity. What I wanted to say is that this reparametrization is not general, it's an accident of this theory. If you consider the quadratic general theory, this invariance, this symmetry is not there in general. And this can actually contribute to modifying the propagation of gravitational waves, because now this N is an additional scalar field that governs the this friction term and the propagation speed of gravitational waves, which is not a good thing to have. Okay, so now if you go to perturbations, as I said, you cannot fix any gates, so you have to work with all the perturbations. If you have the equations, you can still perform a gauge diffeomorphism. And then, since you don't have diffeomorphisms anymore, the transform equations for the scalar perturbations are different from the original equations. However, if you put yourself on a maximally symmetric background, that means Minkowski, De Sitter, and De Sitter, there is a residual gauge symmetry where the gauge parameters are linked by this relation. And this is again a problem, because this means that these backgrounds have an enhanced accidental gauge symmetry. So again, this will be responsible for the absence of degrees of freedom that are within the theory. And this is an indication that these degrees of freedom will be strongly coupled. So any cosmology that you want to do with these theories, and where either you go near a De Sitter point or you go to very small scales where the metric is essentially Minkowski, these modes will be strongly coupled. So phenomenologically, for cosmology, these theories, I would say, are not very good. Okay. So this was for the symmetric teleparallels. If you work with the metric, with the theories having only torsion, the same thing happens. So there you have a local Lorentz symmetry, and whenever you try to extend it, either by considering other tuned quadratic form or nonlinear extensions, you will find that the local Lorentz symmetry is lost, and then you have additional degrees of freedom associated to the breaking of gauge symmetries, and they are ghost-like, they are pathological. So this is what we saw here. I will not go into detail because it's essentially the same. Okay, and now let me go to a more general framework. So let's assume that we take the general metric affine framework where the connection is free, the metric is free, they're independent. And we consider an axiom that is some function of the metric and the Ricci. These are theories that have been studied in the literature lately a lot. And so I will argue that these theories are either pathological or general relativity. How do we see that? Okay, as usual, we perform a Legendre transformation to linearize in the Ricci. Here we see that the metric G only enters there, it will be there and here. So the equation of motion will be algebraic. The metric is an auxiliary field, so we can integrate it out. And then upon some field redefinitions, this one in particular, we can rewrite, this is what I was saying, the axiom in the form of Einstein-Hilbert plus some matter sector where, well, since I've integrated out this G, there will be some new interactions. For instance, if you start here with a canonical scalar field, partial mu phi, partial mu phi, here you will end up with some K essence. Now, this looks like Einstein-Hilbert, but it is not, because I've introduced this object as the derivative with respect to this sigma, which is essentially the derivative with respect to the Ricci. But the Ricci for a general connection is not symmetric, so this object doesn't need to be symmetric. So rather than Einstein-Hilbert, what we have here is this, where Q mu can be non-symmetric. And this has some common properties with these non-symmetric gravity theories that Moffa introduced in 79, and that have non-pathological character. So they have instabilities, as shown in this paper, for instance. But with this formulation, it's easier to see why these pathologies come about. Because take now an object, Q mu nu, and let's expand around some symmetric background. This will be the metric. And this is the quadratic, so the perturbations. This is antisymmetric. B is the perturbation of the antisymmetric piece. Alpha and beta are introduced because you have the freedom to perform field redefinitions of the field B. In any case, when you introduce this in the action, you find this thing here where H is the field strength of these two forms. This is fine because this is a massive Kalman-Romov field. That's okay. This is GR. That's okay. But the problem is that we have this mode, this gamma nu, that is a projective mode, with a kinetic term that only enters via this mixing with B. But it doesn't have any proper kinetic term. So this means that the internal metric for this object will be the Minkowski metric. And that means that you have one positive eigenvalue and one negative eigenvalue. So either one of the modes in B mu nu is a ghost, or this gamma nu is a ghost. The other problem is these non-minimal couplings. Now, you can think of B mu nu, if you take some decoupling limit, B mu nu can be some field strength of a vector field. And then here you recognize a coupling of, if you want, some F mu nu to the curvature. And unless this coupling is of the Hondesky vector tensor interaction, you will find ghosts. You could say, okay, I can tune these parameters to have precisely that. Yes, but this is only the quadratic correction. As soon as you introduce higher order corrections, this will no longer be the case and you will reintroduce the ghost. So this is what I said. You have two sources of pathologies: the absence of a proper kinetic term for the projective mode and these non-minimal couplings for the two form. There are solutions. One is imposing the projective symmetry. So the projective mode is a gauge mode. And that implies that only the symmetric part of the Ricci enters here. And then we do have general relativity. And in that case, we only have general relativity. So it's a very complicated way of writing general relativity. The other solution will be to impose vanishing torsion. And in that case, you find general relativity with some massive vector field. There are other ways to have stable theories, and they usually have to do with introducing restricted geometrical frameworks like Weyl geometries or these kind of things that I will not discuss in more detail. And finally, let me discuss how to introduce matter fields in this framework. From an EFT perspective, I think it's trivial conceptually. Maybe technically can be more or less difficult, but it's clear what we have to do. We are trying to describe interaction of a massless spin 2 particle. This requires a gauge symmetry. So just write down all the operators with those symmetries, and that's it. Okay, and you don't have to worry too much about it. However, being geometrical theory, you could say, okay, but what if I want to stick to the geometrical perspective? Okay, then usually what people do is they invoke some minimal coupling prescription. But this is a decision you have to make. You have to decide how you want to define your minimal coupling prescription. It's not unique. And let me give you some examples. If you have a bosonic field, so for a scalar, it's trivial because partial derivatives go to partial derivatives. There is not much to do there. Unless you have things like Galileans and Hondesky, where you have covariant derivatives, and then there are some decisions to be made there. for gauge fields, sometimes you find that people say, okay, I go from partial to covariant derivative. And when you compute this, you find that you have the usual field strength and a coupling to the torsion. If you want to call this minimal coupling prescription, it's okay. It's just semantics, I guess. But to me, this is not the natural way of coupling a gauge field to an affine connection in general, precisely because this term is breaking the gauge symmetry of the vector field. And the same happened with arbitrary massless p-forms and non-abelian gauge fields. So I would say that actually, so this is tensorial in any affine geometry. So I would say that f mu nu should be to f mu nu of the same type. And this is further supported by the fact that in geometrical terms, a nu, a mu is a connection. So it should enter as part of the affine connection, and that should define the total covariant derivatives of your objects. But here what you're assuming is that a mu is transforming as in some sort of fundamental representation, and that's why you get that. But this is not a good thing to do, in my opinion. Fermions are much trickier because in a general metric affine framework, first you need to define what a fermion is. Usually in Minkowski, fermions are defined in terms of the universal covering group of the Lorentz group, right? And this is, if you want, the special linear group in two dimensions complex. And what you usually do in general relativity to work with fermions is you go to the tangent space, there you impose, or you assume that you have some Lorentz bundle structure, and then the spin connection there gives you an affine connection. There is a one-to-one mapping between a spin connection in the Lorentz frame bundle and the affine connection in the tangent bundle. The problem is that when you have non-metricity, this mapping is not one-to-one. So you cannot take the spin connection and univocally associate an affine connection. This can be seen, for instance, from this property of the gamma matrices, that in general, the gamma matrices are zero. This is obtained from the definition of the Clifford algebra. But if you have non-metricity, the covariant derivatives gets this correction proportional to the non-metricity. This part here is, well, this K is an arbitrary element of this space. And it has to do with the fact that you can perform similarity transformation of the gamma matrices without changing anything. So if you want, it's a sort of gauge symmetry in the election of the gamma matrices. So you can choose it to be zero, for instance. You pick a representative, sorry. Okay. So is this piece what makes things complicated when you want to introduce fermions in a metric affine framework? You can see more details in these papers, but the important point I want to highlight here is that if you take the Dirac axiom and you apply, so you define the covariant derivative in general, and then you expand in post-Riemannian, so the usual covariant derivatives plus terms that depend on the connection, non-metricity and torsion, then you find out that only the totally antisymmetric part of the connection couples to the Dirac field. And this means that the Dirac field only couples to the axial torsion because the non-metricity, the totally antisymmetric part of the non-metricity, is zero. So then whether fermions see torsion or no is, so to some extent, it depends on how you define the coupling of your fermions. But in the worst case scenario, they will couple only to the axial part of the torsion. In the symmetric teleparallel, where the torsion is zero, you don't have this problem. So in that case, it's more natural to have the usual coupling of fermions. In that sense, you don't have any constraint from matter couplings to torsion or non-metricity. Okay. And with this, I conclude. So yeah, I've tried to introduce or uncover the geometrical trinity of gravity, explain some of the main properties. What I wanted to, I guess, highlight is that the metric affine framework provides a much richer geometrical structure to formulate theories. However, it's not that easy to come up with theories free from problems like instabilities or strong coupling. But still, they give you an alternative paradigm to formulate theories of gravity. Because though there are many problems with these theories, there are still healthy regions. And those can be used to have some interesting cosmology in my case, or other phenomenology. And with this, I leave you, and thank you. I hope I'm on time.